members, officers of the church, all the ministers here assembled, all of the elected officials, the appointed governor officials here. I am so honored to be given a few minutes to make some comments to you. Similar to Andre, I don't want to be too long, I've just been given two categories. One is the government category, and the second is the family category. I'm not a preacher, but I'm the granddaughter of a preacher, an important preacher who was the founder of this church. I would just like to ask all the elected officials in the audience to stand, and any appointed government officials, I think Dr. Jones out there, who worked with Reverend Lee. Elected or appointed government officials, if you please say. Thank you. On behalf of myself and Representative Shelley Willingham and Representative Barbara Richardson and Senator Erica Smith Ingram from our legislative delegation, I want to just say how much we are honored to be able to make some expressions for Reverend Dr. Lee and to your family, given this opportunity. As it has already been said, Reverend Lee was amazingly forward-thinking and extremely bold. Similar to Andre, I wouldn't have ever been elected to the Rocky Mount City Council had it not been for the work of Reverend Lee, meetings we had back in the dining hall, many times talking loud to each other, hashing out issues of redistricting, similar to what we're going through right now, how many black voters will be in each of these districts, and how will we share in order to get that fourth seat. And as you all remember, I was the beneficiary of that fourth seat on the city council, representing the African-American community. And it took us 20 years in order to make that happen. And that happened because of agreements and sacrifices we were willing to make among ourselves. He fought for desegregation on many levels. Schools, the police department, city government, sanitation workers. And then his stand for women in the ministry was bold beyond our compare. He was on many commissions. You see much of that in his obituary and program, the Governor's Council on Aging, and it's already been said he would talk about gerontology and gerontological studies, you know, back in the day. You know, Reverend Lee could pronounce a word. And more syllables developed. He would be talking about gerontological studies, and people would lean over and say, what is he talking about? That was before any of us even knew about that. But he was talking about adult care homes and aging, and care for the aging, when it wasn't a popular thing. And for that, we are so proud of all of his service. From a family perspective, as I mentioned to you, my grandfather was the founding pastor of North End Baptist Church, and his brother, Erastus Luther, was the founding pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church on the other side of town. Reverend Lee has often given credit to my aunt, Myrtle Lewis, who is a member and pianist and choir leader here in the church, for helping him get the pastorship. As my grandfather was failing and then eventually passed away. But I was talking about this to my uncle, who's now 95, and he likes to make you all remember that he's the only person that was here when the church was founded. And he told me that Reverend Lee really made his own relationship with my grandpa. He often gave my aunt credit. But Reverend Lee was a friend and a helpmate to my grandfather. And Uncle John says he remembers him being open at the house and how close they were. And he had a vision for himself, and he somehow knew that this was the place he wanted to be. And he did the work it took to position himself to have this role. This was not a stepping stone for him. It was a commitment, as has already been said. He was a wise man, and I used to enjoy, the older he got, the better he was with his speaking. I used to love when he would get up and give remarks, sort of like Rev Burson. He would give a sermon in his remarks, and he wouldn't really take that long. He could make a crack claim in a short amount of time. He knew how to reach out and serve and seize the moment, and he also knew how to let go, and he was the benefit of the blessings he had received. Just as He worked with my grandfather, who had to let go so he could take the reins here. And think about how amazing that is. Now, Reverend Evans, three pastors in 90-some years.
Yeah.
I mean, I love you. I know people have come and gone and might be crosswise and otherwise, but it's no splits and changes and all that. 95 years and standing, and I think that is important. And he was the benefit of that. And I think I want to praise him for taking a retirement himself. I remember talking to him about that. And taking a retirement, he lived to see that North End would be in good hands. Are you going to let this young firebrand, Andre Knight, and this new young group, you know, take the lead? And he was willing to do that. And he was willing to take those risks. And I think that is the wisdom he had. And we will all benefit from that and can learn a lesson for that. And for a while, I think there was a sadness he had with leaving the church. If you had done something for 55 years, and Wilson, just telling you that because we got a primary. And after he retired, I see he and Deacon Wright out and about at the restaurants, and they'd be going to the church programs all over the county. I said, and they were happy they could be. Keeping it up, you know, widowers out there, you know, having a good time. And I would tease them. I said, now, y'all be careful. I'm seeing you too many places. There was a blessing in what he was willing to do, the fact that he was willing to have a vision, he seized it, and that he was willing to let go. And recently, he let go for the last time.
Yeah.
And he will get his reward, and our job is to keep his legacy.
Amen.
Moving.
Now I'm the national champ of the Congressional. 55 years. And I did the math. That means he came here right around 58, 59, 60. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was right around the corner in 1962. And I have no doubt in my mind that Dr. King coming to Rocky Mountain had a profound influence on the life and work of Dr. Elbert Lee. And so I've come to you to come with you today to help you celebrate this great day.
Amen.
Tell this story, then I'll take my seat. I remember when Rocky Mountain was more than 40% African-American. Couldn't elect but one African-American city council member, Dr. Douglas, Reverend Douglas, you remember that. And since it was an at-large city council system, even though Douglas was on the board, he was a weak council member. And I love Reverend Douglas, he was a very good friend of my family. But he was a weak councilman because it was an at-large city election. And then the city of Rocky Mount decided they wanted to annex all that property across 301 Tarrytown and all out Bellevue Road and all out there. They wanted to annex 19 communities into the city of Rocky Mountain, which meant that the African-American community would have even greater difficulty in electing African-Americans to the Rocky Mountain City Council. And it was the Rocky Mountain branch of the NAACP under the leadership of Reverend Dr. Elbert Lee that stood up along with Sue Perry Cole and others, stood up and challenged, and G.K. Butterfield, who challenged the city of Rocky Mountain. Challenged the city of Rocky Mountain, took the case all the way to the United States Department of Justice. Finally, the Department of Justice filed an objection to annexing these 19 areas into the city. And the compromise was to split Rocky Mountain into wards. And then the annexations were approved. And that's why you can have a city council now with 4 out of 7 African American governors. City manager in Rocky Mountain, a chief of police in Rocky Mountain.
Yeah.
I want you to know the connection of Reverend Elbert Lee and the progress that we have made. I remember the school merger and the role that he played in the school merger. My time was running out. I don't have time to develop that, but I remember the school merger and how he led the NAACP in the school merger fight. I remember when Cummings Diesel was getting ready to come to Rocky Mountain and how they were going to buy up all the land around Cummings Diesel. And I remember him leading a delegation from Cummings to negotiate better opportunities for African Americans who worked at Cummings Diesel and to compensate those people who would be losing their land around Cummings Diesel. Family, God bless you. You have a lot to celebrate today. I know your hearts are sad, but your father, your grandfather did great things, not only for your family, but for this community. I come to you today in great celebration. Thank you.